All right, so this is the final chapter with diversity. It's all about vertebrates, their origin, and their evolution. Half a billion years of backbones. We have lots of invertebrate animals that were in the Earth's oceans around 530 million years ago, and one of those is what allowed us to have vertebrates, probably the most successful groups of animals that we have. They get their name from their vertebrae. The bones make up their backbone. We have a lineage of vertebrates that colonized land 365 million years ago. About 52,000 species of vertebrates, and they have quite a diversity among them. Chordates are bilaterian animals that belong to the clade Deuterostomia. They include all of our vertebrates, along with two groups of invertebrates, the urochordates and fun. All right, so there's kind of the breakdown of Deuterostomia. Derived characters, chordates all have in common. Some of them we do not see in their morphological features. They're present only in their embryonic element, notochord, dorsal hollow nerve cord, pharyngeal slit clefts, and the muscular postanal tail. All right, and we'll talk about each of those. The notochord is a longitudinal flexible rod in your digestive tube and your nerve cord. It's going to be able to provide skeletal support. Most vertebrates, we get a more complex skeleton that develops, and only remnants of that are present. The dorsal hollow nerve cord of a chordate embryo is able to develop from a plate that rolls into a tube that is the notochord. This is able to form your central nervous system and your brain and your spinal cord. Pharyngeal slits or clefts. This is pretty wild. Grooves in the pharynx that develop in the slits that open outside of the body. What do they do? Your invertebrate cortex, they provide for your vertebrates. They are able to exchange gases for the tetrapods, the ones with limbs. And for the tetrapods, they are what gives you your ears, your head, and your neck. The muscular postanal tail is posterior to your anus. It is greatly reduced as you go through your development as an embryo. It contains skeletal elements and muscles, and for aquatic species, is able to provide a swelling force. Okay, so the lancelets, cephalochordates, are named for their blade-like shape. They are marine suspension feeders, and they keep most of the chordate body plan as adults. The tunicates, the urochordates, are more closely related to chordates than the lancelets. They tend to resemble the chordates only during their larval stage, which is very short. They draw on water for an in-current siphon, which is able to poke for their food. When they are attacked, they are able to shoot water through it. They are very drive, highly drive, and they have fewer hawks. So, ancestral chordates way back in the day may have resembled our lancelets. The same hawk genes that organize the vertebrate brain are expressed in the lancelet's simple nerve cord. And then, based on DNA sequencing, we've been able to determine that genes associated with the heart and thyroid are found in all chordates, and genes that are associated with the nerve are unique to vertebrates. So, that BF1 and OTX are the genes that are found both in the nerve cord of the lancelet embryo and the brain of your vertebrate embryo. Craniates are chordates that have heads. So because we have heads, we're able to have more movement and feeding behaviors. Characteristics of all craniates have sharing commons, whole brain, eyes, sensory organs. Craniates have two clusters of hawk genes, while the lancelets and the tunicates only have one. One feature that's unique to neural crest, cells that are near the dorsal margins of that neural tube that's closing in your embryo. The neural crest cells give lots of different structures, bones, and cartilage to your skull. And the aquatic craniates, the pharyngeal clefts, are able to make gill slits. Craniates have a higher metabolism and are more muscular than the tunicates and the lancelets. And they have a heart with at least two chambers, red blood cells with hemoglobin, and kidneys. Okay, so there's the tube closing, and You can see in part C the neural cells that have migrated around that neural tube, how they were able to form bones and cartilage to help make up skulls. Where did craniates come from? We can look at fossils from the Cambrian explosion to kind of see this transition. Talks about the most primitive one, how it had a brain, eyes, and muscles, and have a skull. And as we found more advanced chordates, we see that they do have skull and are classified truly as craniates. Hagfishes. The most basic group of craniates are the Myxini, the hagfishes. They have a cartilage in the skull and an axial rod of cartilage that comes from that notochord. They do not have jaws, they do not have vertebrae. They have a small brain, they have eyes, ears, like formations. They are found in marine environments, and most are bottom dwelling scavengers. Just gross. Anyway, vertebrates. Are craniates that do have backbones. This allowed us to become more efficient at capturing food and being able to survive. Derived characters, we went through vertebrates as a whole. For skin identification with the TLX family of transcription factors, which allowed for different differentiation of expression of those genes. The vertebrates have the following five characters: a vertebrae that includes spinal cord, an elaborate skull, and an aquatic form. Lampreys are the oldest living lineage of vertebrates, jawless vertebrates. They come down their mouth on live fish. Aquatic habitat. They have cartilaginous segments surrounding their notochord, and you can see that in the picture, and also partly over their nerve cord. Early vertebrate fossils, conodonts. First vertebrates with mineralized skeletal elements on both the mouth and their cornix. Their fossilized dental elements are common in your fossil record. And it says that other armored jawless vertebrates have defensive types of bones on their skin. So when we're first seeing the skeleton start to show up, mineralization first seems to have occurred with your mouth. The vertebrate endoskeleton became fully mineralized a lot later. Mathosome, vertebrates that have jaws. Odd vertebrates definitely outnumber our jawless vertebrates. They include your sharks, their relatives, lots of fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, mammals. It's not the jaws that evolved from the skeletal supports of those bronchial slits. Other characters are genome duplication, enlarged forebrain with enhanced sensory capabilities, and then in the aquatic mathosomes, the lateral line system, which allows fossil anathosomes, they were first seen in an extinct lineage of pachyderms that appeared about 450 million years ago. And then we saw another group in the Silurian and Devonian periods, Acanthodians. And then we have three lineages that exist today: Chondrotinus, Brachyfish, and the Lobians. The Chondrotinus are where your sharks and your rays are going to be found. They have a skeleton that's composed primarily of cartilage, and then there are some other species that are subsets of this particular group. Sharks, streamlined body, largest ones are actually suspended feeders. Most of them, as you're well aware of, are carnivores. Very short digestive tract, and they have a ridge that helps increase their surface area, acute senses. They're fertilized internally. Their eggs are fertilized internally, but their eggs can develop as oviparous, where they have outside the mother's body, or the viviparous, where the embryo develops in the uterus and is nourished by the yolk, and the viviparous, where the embryo develops within the uterus and is actually nourished by the placenta. Their respiratory tract, their excretory system, their digestive tract all enter into a common cloaca. Yeah, they move. Right fin fish and low fins. Belong to the anathosome clad that make up the majority of it are called osteichites. Most of these have a bony endoskeleton. It would be your bony fish, your tetrapods. The aquatic ones are what we call our fishes. They breathe, taking water in over gills. They're protected by an operculum. They are able to float or to move through different densities. air sac known as a swim ladder. They have a lateral line system, and most are oviparous. Some do have internal fertilization and birthing. Rayfin fishes, Achnoparagi, include all of what the aquatic plastic ions that we are familiar with. They first appeared during the Silurian period. Their fins, just supported by their long flexible rays, are able to allow them to move and defend themselves along with other fishes. Examples. Lobe fins, muscular pelvic and pectoral fins. They too came about during the Silurian period. Some lineages that still exist today are the coelacanths, the lungfishes, and the tetrapods. The fact that they are coelacanths are actually extinct now and off of South Africa in 1938. So there are some examples of those. And then we have tetrapods. Tetrapods are anathemas that have limbs. When some of these lobe fins evolved into limbs and feet, broad characters that specifically have are your forearm limbs, feet with digits, and neck, which allows the move head to move simply. The fusion of the pelvic girdle to the backbone, no more gills unless you're aquatic, and ears to be able to detect sounds. Origin of tetrapods, had both fish and tetrapod characteristics. It had the fins and the gills, it had ribs, it had a neck. Probably propped itself on its limbs, but couldn't walk. This was first seen, our first fossil have been seen around 3,000 years ago. Okay, so there's fish characters on the left, fossil characters on the right, and the fossil shown evidence of both of those species. Amphibians. These are represented by many, many, many species. We have a few orders of them. We have the Urabella, which is the salamanders, the tails, the Anura, which is frogs and toads that don't have tails. The Apoda, which are the cichlids, the legless and the worms. Amphibian means that you both ways of life, so that you have aquatic larvae that turn into land-based adults. You have moist skin, and that helps your lungs with pathogens. Fertilization tends to be external, eggs require a moist environment. Some species actually carry their eggs on their back or in their mouth or in their stomach. These populations are declining in part due to fungi, loss of habitat, climate change, and pollution, common causes that we've been seeing. Amniotes are tetrapods that have a terrestrial adapted egg. Those are your reptiles such as birds and mammals. Derived characters of these. Basic derived characters, the amniotic egg, which has membranes to protect the embryo. Embryonic membranes include the amnion, the chorion, the yolk sac, and the elenchoid. Most reptiles and mammal amniotic eggs have a shell. Terrestrial adaptations are mostly impermeable skin, ability to use rib cage, and plate cloth. Amphibians and amniotes are thought to have split from a common ancestor about 3.5 million years ago. They were more tolerant of dry conditions than the early tetrapods, and they tended to be small predators in their earliest forms, the sharp teeth and long claws. Reptiles include your tetrapods, lizards, snakes, turtles, crocodilians, birds, and some other groups. They have scales that create a waterproof barrier. They lay shelled eggs on land. Reptiles, for the most part, are ectothermic. They absorb heat to get their body warm. Birds tend to be endothermic. They keep their body warm from metabolism. Origin, evolution, and radiation of reptiles. These date back as fossils to the Carboniferous period. The first group was known as the parareptiles, large, stocky, quadrupedal herbivores. As these were mostly diapsids, which formed into Leptosaurus and the Archosaurus. The leptosaurus are your tetrapods, the lizards, snakes, mosasaurs, and then the archosaurus gave us crocodilians, pterosaurs, and our dinosaurs. Pterosaurs were the first ones that were able to fly. Dinosaurs, as we are aware, ranged into a lot of different sizes. These included pteropods, bipedal carnivores, where birds come from. We're not real sure whether that's endothermic or exothermic. Based on fossil discoveries and research, we believe dinosaurs were very agile and able to move quickly, and that they created their offspring. Again, dinosaurs, other than birds, came extinct at the end of the Cretaceous period, which is thought to be in part because of that. Dinosaurs are represented by two species, or one thriving lineage is represented by two species of lizard-like reptiles called Tuatara's. The other one consists of the squamates, the lizards, and the snakes. Lizards by far are the most numerous, other than the birds and the reptiles. Snakes are legless leptosaurs that evolved from lizards. And snakes, carnivorous, and as we are well aware, are venomous. Cartilage, that box-like shell made of upper and lower shields, is fused to their vertebrae, their clavicles, and their ribs. Some turtles are totally fine living in the desert, others can only live in more aquatic environments. Alligator crocodiles, these date back to one of the archosaur lineages, the late Triassic period. So there's some pictures. Birds are archosaurs, but almost all of their reptilian anatomy features have been modified to allow them to adapt to flying. Right, characters. Major adaptation is wings. Other adaptations, not having a urinary bladder, females only have one ovary, small gonads, plus a teeth. Being able to fly allows them to hunt and scavenge more quickly, be able to escape from predators, and be able to migrate. Because flying requires a lot of energy, and they need to have really good vision and excellent muscle control. It's thought that birds probably descended from the theropods, a group of carnivorous dinosaurs. The feathers might have evolved for insulation, to be able to camouflage themselves or to find reproductive partners. How would feathers help dinosaurs? Would it help them gain lift when they jump, or tractor running up hills, or to glide on trees? About 150 million years ago, the other theropods were able to evolve into birds. Archaeopteryx means the oldest bird that is known. Which birds belong to Neorhynchus? Several groups of birds do not fly. The ratites, penguins, and we also have the rails, ducks, and pigeons that can fly. Because flight time is pretty intense, and so they've rendered body form as many flying birds to one another. So if birds are able to fly, they often look quite a lot alike. Mammals. They are represented by more than 5,300 species. Carved characters for the mammary glands are able to produce milk. Hair, metabolic rate because of endothermy. Large brain compared to other vertebrates that are of the same size. Differentiated teeth. Some mammals evolved from synapses. Bones that made a solid joint ended up turning into a mammalian middle ear. At the beginning of the early Cretaceous period, three living lineages of mammals emerged: the monotremes, marsupials, and the eutherians. And they did not go through any significant adaptive radiation until after this Cretaceous period. Monotremes are egg-laying mammals, echinoids, and the platypus is probably the one that you're more familiar with. Marsupials are your opossums, your kangaroos, and your koalas. The embryo develops the placenta and the mom's uterus. As it's born super early, it finishes its development in a maternal pouch called the marsupium. And Australia, convergent evolution has built in a great diversity of marsupials that look like the Aetherians throughout the rest of the world. So there's some example of marsupial mammals versus Aetherian mammals. Aetherians are your placentals. They have a more complex placenta. They actually keep their embryonic development within the uterus, going to the mom. And there are surprise states about the Aetherian diversification. Okay, so you can see all the different clads that belong to the Eutherians. There are all the different orders that are out there. Primates is the one we're going to focus on right now. Your lemurs, your tortoises, monkeys, and your apes. Humans would be a part of the ape group. Five characters for the primates include hands and feet, so you can grasp things, flat nails, large brains, short jaws, eyes that are forward looking on together on the face to help with depth perception, social behavior that's very complex, caring for offspring, fully opposable thumb in monkeys and apes. Three major groups of living primates, your lemurs, your tortoises, and your anthropoids, monkeys and your apes. Oldest known anthropoid fossils about 45 million years ago. The tortoises are most closely related to the anthropoids and lemurs. First monkeys showed up in Africa and Asia. In South America, we started to see them about 25 million years ago. Both the New World and the Old World monkeys have separate adaptive radiations since they were separated for millions of years. A group of anthropoids of primates is known as apes. Gibbons, orangutans, gorillas, chimpanzees, bonobos, and humans, and apes emerged from Old World monkeys about 20 to 25 million years ago. Humans. Well, sapiens, about 100,000 years old, which is pretty young, given life on Earth for about 3.5 million years. Five characters that distinguish humans from apes. Different posture, bipedal locomotion, large brains that can do all the things we do, reduced jawbones, jaw muscles, shorter digestive tract. Human and chimpanzee genomes are 99% identical, but the regulatory gene's ability to be transcribed and translated at varying times and with varying purposes has had large effects. Hominins. Study of human origins is known as paleoanthropology. Hominins, used to be called hominins, are more closely related to humans than your chimpanzees. They have found about 3 species of hominins that are thought to originate in Africa about 6-7 million years ago. They are showing the smaller brains and more metabolism. Misconceptions about hominins. The hominins and chimpanzees feature a common ancestor, but they were not the same. And human evolution is the latter that leads directly to Homo sapiens. Evolution is hominin evolution consisted of many branches or coexisting species, although Homo sapiens are the only ones that really exist today. Not a ladder considering branches off of it. Australopithecus, paraphyletic assemblage of hominins between 4 and 2 million years ago. Some are able to walk fully erect. Some have two skulls, powerful jaws. More slender and had larger jaws. Hominin characteristics are bipedalism, being able to walk long distances on two legs, and being able to use tools. Early Homo species, earliest fossils based in our genus are Homo habilis, and then we had Homo ergaster, and then we had Homo erectus. Homo habilis was 2.4 to 1.6 million years ago, found stone tools with it. Homo ergaster was the first fully bipedal large brain hominid. 1.9 to 1.5 million years ago, significant decrease in sexual dimorphism, aka the size difference between males and females, was not as noticeable. Then Homo erectus first went to leave Africa and is thought to have shown up around 1.8 million years ago. Neanderthals lived in Europe and the Near East 300,000 to 28,000 years ago. Found large brain, they buried their dead, they made hunting tools. And there's still ongoing debate about the genetic material exchange between us and the Neanderthals. These Homo sapiens showed up about 195,000 years ago. This is what we came from. Oldest fossils left in Africa are about 115,000 years old and date from the Middle East. We arrived in the New World about 15,000 years ago. In 2004, they found some 18,000 year old fossils in Indonesia and came up with another group of hominins. Homo sapiens are thought to be the first group to show evidence of symbolism and advanced thought. They found a drawing in South Africa kind of representing the symbolism. And so that's just kind of going over all the different clades with chordates. And that is the end of diversity.